Good evening and welcome to the Thursday, November 10th, 2016 meeting of the Northampton School Committee. I'm Mayor David Narkowitz, and we'll begin the meeting by asking our clerk to call the roll.
Dr. Summers here.
Here.
Ms. Molly Martin?
Here.
Present.
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 Here.
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 Present.
Present. Excellent. Thank you. We'll begin our meeting this evening with the public comment period. Is there anyone who wishes to offer public comment? Okay. Seeing none, we'll now move into announcements. And do we have announcements from the school committee? Mr. Reed, I know, has an announcement.
I would like to remind everybody that this is what they're going to be doing on Saturday night. They're going to be going to the reprom at the VFW, 7:30 to 11. You don't need fancy clothes. It says tuxedos to tennis shoes. Anything goes. So, and it's going to be fun, and more importantly, it's a benefit for NEF, which is celebrating its 25th anniversary, and in its 25 years has contributed over $1 million to programs that benefit our teachers and our students. So, good cause.
Yes.
I would like to thank the superintendent for collaborating with the Amherst superintendent and reaching out to families through letters and a phone call about the election and touching base with children and their families. It was really wonderful to see the collaboration and to take the time.
Any other announcements from members of the school committee? Okay, hearing none, we'll move into the recommended actions. And we have a consent agenda this evening, which has the approval of minutes of the Rules and Policy Subcommittee of October 19th, 2016, and the Curriculum Subcommittee of October 26, 2016. We also have some field trip requests, the NHS Quiz Bowl team pre-holiday academic tournament at South Burlington High School in South Burlington, Vermont, December 2nd through the 3rd, 2016. And then the 8th grade French students trip to Quebec City in Quebec, Canada, May 26th through the 28th, 2017.
Make a motion to approve the consent agenda as presented.
Okay, the motion is made and seconded. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, so the consent agenda is adopted for this evening. We'll now move to reports and recommendations. And we have, first up is a report from our student representative, Elena Fragamini.
Hi, everyone. Elena Fragamini. I'm a junior at Northampton High School, and I'm from our student union. Great to be here with you tonight, so thank you again for having me. At the high school, it was the end of our first quarter. Grades closed yesterday, so teachers have been doing midterms, just grading a lot of tests, finishing up first quarter. In terms of the election, our high school was pretty shaken up yesterday, but our teachers did a really great job of facilitating some super important conversations. A lot of teachers related it to the subject matter, and as a whole, today was much better day, able to move forward with our curriculum. Big thanks to our teachers and our administration. And again, the transcript Northampton High School student news broadcast is still up and running. We had a special election episode last week. Members of our team traveled to New Hampshire and were credentialed media for a Donald Trump rally as well as a Hillary Clinton rally where President Barack Obama spoke. That can be found at nhstechnology.org. And NHS now has a TV in the front of the building near the office to show the transcript and recordings of high school events. Arts Night In is next Friday, November 18th. That's 6 to 8 p.m. We'll be highlighting our vibrant arts community at NHS, and I encourage you all to come. The Student Union is continuing to collaborate with the NHS administration on a bunch of issues. We're continuing to do research on the senior dismissal date, mostly to answer some questions that the high school seniors have about the change in that. But we've been meeting with Mr. Lombardi and really moving along to answer students' questions. We've also made significant headway in returning to using reusable trays in the cafeteria. For the past couple months, we've been using styrofoam trays, but with the help of our food services director, we are waiting on dishwasher repairs and we'll be back to reusable trays, as well as moving towards using silverware to make ourselves a sustainable and climate-friendly cafeteria. And also a quick update, we received numerous letters from our freshmen to join the student union, so we'll be working towards being a truly representative body. And that's pretty much it. If you have any questions or want to know anything else, feel free to ask.
Thank you, Elena. The next item on the agenda is an update, and this is an overview of the NPS English Language Learners, or ELL, program. And I believe we have Heather Berlin, Kathy Malinowski, and Sue Sullivan who are here this evening. Is that correct? Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay, thanks for having us. My name is Sue Sullivan. I'm the Northampton High School ELL teacher. And I'd like to introduce Kathy Malinowski, the Jackson Street ELL teacher, as well as Heather Berlin, the Northampton High School ELL teacher.
Hi.
So we were invited here by Dr. Provost and Laurie Farkas to give an overview of the wonderful and growing ELL student population in the Northampton Public Schools.
Thanks for having us. So yeah, again, I'm Heather Berlin. I'm at the high school, though I used to be at JFK. It's always nice to come back. So can everybody see the PowerPoint up there? So we're gonna go through and show you some images and some statistics. Ooh, this makes me feel very fancy. So just a quick overview for you of our NPS ELL students. So it's pretty small. On the screen, but you can see back to even 2006. So in the past 10 years or so, our ELL population has been going up. Our numbers are up this year from last year. We don't have a great count because those are June numbers. I'm sorry, no, those are October numbers. So we don't have those this year, but you can see that there's been steady increase in the ELL population. And back beyond 2006 as well. And as you can see on the slide on the right, this is our first year with an ELL service delivery at Leeds. So we have some numbers there. We have ELL students at Ryan Roads. That means all five elementary schools, four elementary schools. and then also a pre-K program. Otherwise, our ELLs are mainly at Jackson Street, NHS, and JFK. So yeah, quick overview of countries. As you can see, ELLs are from all over the world. Our biggest communities of students are typically from Ecuador and other Latin American countries in Central and South America, as well as Puerto Rico, which is not a country separate from the US, however, distinct. And our languages, again, are very diverse. So this is definitely not a complete list, so we may have more languages this year, but as you can see, really varied. So most of our ELLs are Spanish speakers. However, there's a very diverse population this year and every year. So we have Quechua. I don't know if you've heard of Quechua. It's the Ecuadorian indigenous language that a lot of our students speak. And Punjabi and Hindi from India. So as you can see, our numbers, our population is very diverse. It's remarkably diverse, not just in their country and language, but also in class, academic history, family history, and their background, et cetera. So we want to give you some information today about our current ELL population. But please keep in mind that each and every year the population changes. And each and every student is unique and may not fit the profile that we're going to try to paint for you today. And in order to be a little bit more accurate and specific, we're going to focus on NHS students just for a few more statistics because I, as I work there, have better access to those numbers. Also, we anticipate that so at least some of the refugees that are coming in will go to the high school. Keep in mind the specific context of NHS compared to the other schools, right? So the academics demands are very high. So a student coming in who has limited English is going to have a very large gap between what they can produce and what the 11th or 12th grade students who have been in the country since they were born can produce. And in addition, our growing and developing ELL program at the high school has changed a lot. So we actually have, we're very proud, Sue and I, of what we have built and looking forward to continuing to grow. We now have three different levels of ELL classes. So we have a beginning class, intermediate, advanced. We also teach some history courses in order to make sure students have access to the curriculum. As you can imagine, many don't have the same background knowledge when they come in. And also we now have a content support class. So keep in mind all of those things, and then I'm going to give you a couple of numbers. Now, I put these together, right? So I hope that they are pretty accurate. For this one definitely is. Our socioeconomic status of students, most NHS ELLs receive free lunch. So these are just numbers right off of Aspen using who gets free and reduced lunch. And so as you can see, 18 of our students for this year out of a total of, that looks like 26, are of low socioeconomic status. So that gives us a lot of information, but it's just one factor. Also, I pulled up this information using what Sue Sullivan and I have been able to compile based on an informal screening that we do of students when they arrive. So this is not a formal documented number. However, what we'll do is when a Spanish speaker and sometimes other languages come to us, we can get a sense of their native language literacy. And this is important because it's a significant factor in their academic success in English. So, you know, think about it. If you're coming from a place where you don't read on grade level in your native language, to then learn English and also be learning skills of learning how to read, maybe for the first time, it gets more challenging and more complex. And it means that as educators, our job is a little bit more complicated. So as you can see, a clear majority of our students at the high school enter school with literacy skills in their native language that are below grade level. On the left, you see students with native language literacy below grade level. Again, they're informal numbers, and usually we can say that they are very clearly below grade level. So for example, some of our Spanish speakers are coming in with elementary school reading level in Spanish. So that's about 73% of our students. Another piece of terminology that I want to give you is a term called SLIFE. Some of you may have heard of this before, and some of you may not have heard of this before. Sue's going to tell you some more information about SLIFE students at the high school. Do you want me to do this slide? Come on.
Thank you.
Okay, so SLIFE is a relatively new subset of ELL students. As you can see, it means students with limited or interrupted formal education. As you read the slide, you'll note that there is besides a formal definition, the main concern is that these students are functioning 2 years or more below expected grade level in native language literacy as well as numeracy. And as Heather was saying before, we're seeing increasing numbers of those students at the secondary level. So DESE, as well as New York and several other states in this country, have come out with SLIFE guidelines. So there is a formal definition of these students, as well as guidelines for educating them and entering them into the school systems. Here is a really rough slide. This is just a draft of the population that we see right now at Northampton High School of SLIFE students in the past 3 years. And that's just the draft. Okay, some of the challenges that we are seeing with the ELL students are threefold. They're academic, cultural, and social and emotional. And as Dr. Provost has been really educating the whole district about, many of our students are multi-layered, and you can't meet the challenges of one of these areas without trying to support the other ones and seeing success in the other areas. So I'm gonna start with academic. So students are coming from a variety of different backgrounds. We're seeing students that are coming from private schools and students coming from rural schools. It's important to note that these are different skill sets and can be taught in different ways and also dealt with as challenges. Here, this slide shows you some of the different backgrounds that our students are coming from. There's informal ways of learning, and in no way do we want to be disparaging of these students of what their educational background is in their native country. But also, we want to note that it's a really big change for them to go from some of their schooling in their native country to a formal U.S. education. We're just learning how to be a student is a big process. This is a really great quote that Heather found from an ELL student that is not one of ours, just about how vastly different the literacy landscape is in the new country of the United States. So I'll let you read that for a minute. And I really think it speaks volumes about the urgency of their education once they come to this country. So the cultural challenges are also multi-layered, everything from food to clothing to religion. One story that I can share with you is last year I was working in three different schools. I was at Bridge Street, and a student of Cambodian heritage told me that she would bring in her native Cambodian meals, and some of the other kids made fun of her, and subsequently she didn't bring in her native meals for like the next 4 years. So there can be long-term effects, and cultural challenges are very real for these students. Social-emotional challenges are also great. So I'm just going to skip right next to the next slide. Here is a slide that Heather made that shows how a lot of these students are torn between two different countries, the new country and the new culture that they need to be accepting, and also the country and culture that they left, and how it can be very difficult.
Just jump in there for 1 second.
Yeah.
So also a part of this is like many of our students are born in the U.S., right? They're born in Northampton. They are American. Most of our students identify as being American. And at the same time, they bring their cultural and their identity, their language identity from their native country, at least of their parents. And so balancing that, living in both of those, being able to recognize and value and sort of balance both of those things is something that I cannot necessarily understand, but I do see as being a huge part of their, especially for adolescents, mm-hmm. huge part of their challenge in making a new life here.
Some additional challenges that we're seeing are probably the greatest ones. We have students who are suffering from trauma, from separation from family members and caregivers. Obviously, students coming out of poverty, students who have had very dangerous journeys to the United States. And on top of that, they have to have certain expectations when they come to this country. A lot of our older students are working as well as providing childcare at home. So they're negotiating many different very serious things. And I don't want to end on too negative a note, but the fear, the political fear of discrimination and violence is more real than when we created this slideshow last week. So we already have had students express fears to us in the past few days, and we are very, you know, concerning and trying to help them be supported and feel safe in our community. And with that, I'm going to head off to Kathy is going to present the end slides.
So what we're looking at is how are we supporting our ELLs and what we are already doing. And we made a list of the things that we could think of. There's more to this list, but it's important to take a look at that. The top of the list is the providing rigorous standards-based curriculum aligned to WIDA, which is the standards for those ELL learning capacities in the languages of math and science and social studies and reading and listening, as well as social language. That's what the WIDA part is, and the CSS is something I'm sure you're familiar with. So we have to juggle both of those And as well as when we're talking about on the third point, is that our teachers in our classroom are part of the team of people who provide support for our ELLs. We might have a particular group of students that we're working with, but they return to other teachers who have SEI endorsement, and then the accommodations are made in their classroom, so they're getting all of that content area as well. We're offering through Title III monies, summer school, and other tutoring, and for high school students, they're able to get some credit. There's opportunities that way. We've been ensuring that core teachers and administrators over the last few years have been learning through the SEI retail course about all the good stuff that they need to know, and there's a lot of things to know. Our next part is we've been trying to, over the years, and this is my beginning of my fourth decade. I know I don't look it, but that's true. You know, that's just the way it is. So in my 31st year here in Northampton as an ESL teacher, we've been trying to do throughout the system at different times, build capacity for having first language supports, if possible. And more recently, it's that we've been looking at some low incidence languages that we might have a child or two that really needs to have support. That can happen depending on who's in our schools. But when we're looking at most of the other Spanish-speaking faculty and staff that we have throughout the district is that they're Spanish speakers as well as English speakers. And that's one of the things that I still see people who I've known for many years that have been working in our school system. Providing native language support for students whenever possible is extremely helpful. As much as we'd like to say, oh, they're going to learn English so fast, and it appears that they do. But there is so much to learning English. It's not just that chit-chat kind of information. It's also about being able to be doing that academic learning that everybody else is expected to do. Our students are expected to be making strides in that as well. So whenever we can use clarification so we can really get to the meat of information, if it's possible, we can use that. But our medium of instruction is in English, and it's a very tiresome situation for students, for sure. We're able to bring in volunteers from a number of sources, through VINS, through the five colleges, NHS Honor Society. They've been doing that for a number of years, which is really commendable to have peer support and doing that kind of learning at the high school level. So it's something that I've been really admiring for many years. And when possible, we try to provide as many American experiences through field trips. And again, we've been using Title III monies for the last few years, and of course, NEF grants. And when students are participating in their schools, in their classrooms, going to the farm, that's what they do at Jackson Street, and they've done a number of different kinds of field trips recently. The kids are having those experiences as well. So we try to get them ready a little bit before they go, so when they see those things, they'll be able to make a connection. Our next slide, we have one more after this, so we're getting close. Supporting our ELLs, what we need to do better. And of course, there's always things that teachers think that they can do better because they have to rework things on a daily basis. But if we look at a few ideas that we're thinking about, is that we would like to continue working towards the recommended service delivery for ESL instruction. So we have built, we're trying to build capacity at all the elementary schools and provide as much support that we can for our students. To look over on the right-hand side, the WIDA levels that we have found that how we kind of frame kids learning at the moment is that kids who are beginners or are levels 1 and 2, they would, just for ESL instruction, would benefit from up to 2.5 hours per day, if not more. And level 3, that means they've got more English, but they're still learning English, and we are looking at 1 to 2 hours per day from an ESL teacher. And then as we go through the levels until level 6, this is where we determine that a student is no longer in need of services from us, from the ESL staff, but we really encourage students to be in classrooms where teachers have the SEI credential, because they have that lens that they can use to support students. And the interesting thing in the recent DESE guidance in 2016 of in August is that instead of 2 years of monitoring our students when they exit the program, so to speak, we're now looking at a four-year monitor, which is really great. So that means we have to keep them in our view for an for a long time. And the more academic growth that kids have to make, we have to be able to, you know, you give a little boost now and again. It depends on what happens, but we'll be seeing how this four-year monitor works for the next 4 years for each student. We're also looking at supporting a wide range of social emotional needs, as we've mentioned previously, and because the district is as a whole is looking at that, like the PD that we just had on Tuesday, it was a really wonderful connection that I immediately was thinking about several of my students and trying to figure out how to use that and to apply it. And I even tried it Wednesday. Didn't work out so hot, but you know, I've got other things I can use. And our stronger resources and networks of native language support for students and families. We've got a lot of different things, different groups in the community that are there to support us and to support our students and to support their families. And it really is it takes a village situation. It's not something that the school can take total ownership for. It's a sharing across the community. And then our last part is improving the newcomer intake programs and protocols. We have, my experience this year at Jackson, we've had five newcomers and one in each grade. So that means a fifth grader who is newcomer to English is not going to be sitting with a kindergartner first grade, I mean, a first grader newcomer, because they're the things that they have to do and know about being in fifth grade is about being in fifth grade. So there's a lot of different ways that we have to figure out how best to support students. And it's just, it depends, what really depends on our willingness to be flexible and figure out what it is that we can do with students at the time that they're with us. And that we have, again, a number of kids that come in and stay for a while and then leave, but we have to make the best of the time that they're with us. And it's hard to have them go, but that's just the way that life happens to be for a lot of students. And the last slide here is our guiding question is why this matters now more than ever. Having had attended the meeting in October, that we had, you know, better than 200 people coming to look at the idea of refugee people coming to our community, brings me back to 1985 when I was at Bridge Street School, and I had at the end of that summer was hired to teach children who were coming from Thailand refugee camps where there were Cambodian students had gone to be. So as far as having a history in Northampton, we have had a history of refugee students in Northampton. And that was at the elementary level, but we also had students at the middle and high school level at that time. So when we're looking at our growing diverse high need population, is already happening. So the idea is to think about how do we fold in newcomers, even though their experience might be different than what we're used to be having. But we've had on and off over the years, we've had students from Bosnia, we've had students from the Ivory Coast. There's been a lot of, depending on what brings them to Northampton. So I'm always considering and thinking about what are the push and pull factors that bring them to Northampton at this time. And I think when we're looking at the arrival of refugees, that we're thinking that we have pursued this, and it's like, oh, okay, so this is what we know, the reason why they're coming to Northampton, and what are we as a collective group of people are going to do to serve them? And that's very different from 1985 when, oh, here we have some kids that have just arrived. That's a very different thing. So I'm very pleased that there is a lot of thought and talk about what to do and how do we as a group and as a community deal with this. So that's the end of our presentation, and we'd welcome any questions that you might have, and we'll try to answer them.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for the presentation. Are there questions or comments from the school committee? Yes, Ms. Byrne.
I really appreciate you coming in and making those slideshow for us to see all your data. I would love to know the slide that said how much services, the 2.5 hours or 1 hour and the levels, is that services in the classroom or is that blended services?
That's for ESL direct service from an ESL teacher, like one of us.
In a separated?
It could be push in or pull out at the middle school. In the high school level, that's actually
pull out,
the pull out piece,
we have
or just like
classroom
the,
for them.
The regular.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But Destiny says it can be push in or pull out as long as it's direct service from a certified ELL teacher.
And you're making that choice and figuring out what's best for the students and responding.
Yeah. Depending on the numbers and. Mm-hmm.
Well, and
our staff.
The flexibility of our school situation, schedule. You know, we would love to do more kinds of different kinds of service delivery at the high school, but it's hard with block scheduling. So, based on lots of factors.
Yes, Ms. Fallon.
I'm not sure I understand what it means that the DES is extending the monitoring period to 4 years if a student's passed. It's level 6 and they're no longer eligible, but then you see they're struggling. Do you have to kind of reassign them back to level 5, or like how is that process going to work?
We've been asked for many years to be watching students for 2 years. So I think because we're always thinking about the academic demands that are great, that are just very great on students, and as they get older and move up in grades, the academic demand is even stronger. So it's this idea that I think it kind of has a built-in idea that we're all responsible for the learning of this student. So it's not like, oh, done. We know you've acquired English enough to handle yourself in all ways possible. When we know that just how students develop, and even if we're able to support in some way, we can do some support. So I don't know how that's going to look after
we keep
going. Yes, okay. But it's a really it depends kind of thing, and we have at different times we have to be ready to receive a student back again for whatever that particular academic need might be.
And some of that I think comes from that as scholarship is growing, people are seeing that reclassified or exited ELLs are still struggling. Not all, obviously, but many still are struggling. And so to monitor them, we are making sure as a school and as a district that we are keeping tabs on them and collaborating with teachers to support them. So it may mean, say, a student is continuing to struggle, we may just meet with teachers and change their schedule, you know. But at the same time, the guidelines are flexible, so we can re-identify a student if it seems like that's what's best for them. So it's not, it would be paperwork, but it's not a black and white thing with ELL. You can come in and go out. I have never done that, but needed if a student situation changed, we could do that.
Elena and then Anne.
I was wondering if you had any data in terms of the high school of ELL students or ELL students that have moved on past ELL who are taking honors or AP courses?
We have not tracked specific data on that. We do have students in both of those categories, but we haven't done, that would be definitely something that we would like to do.
Okay. But I know the data team, or I heard that the data team at the high school in the past has looked at those numbers, not just for ELLs, but students in other minority categories. Okay. And I don't know what that data is, but maybe Brian, do you know, do you remember any of that? We could find it if you're interested, but I think it is what you would expect, that not related to the total population of ELLs, total population of students, there's not as high of a population of ELLs and minority students in honors and AP classes.
Okay.
But we're working on it.
Ms. Hennessy.
I might have 3 questions, but it might not be. If you have a WIDA 1, level 1 or 2, are they in US history class?
For the district, or you mean like at the high school?
At the high school level. I'm speaking at the high school level. And if they are, what kind of supports are they getting within the classroom?
Well, usually at freshman level, they're all going into early modern. So we have started doing 2 history classes in the ELL department. We're doing early world history, and we're doing early U.S. history. So level ones and twos would be...
Have them.
Yeah, would be with us.
Okay.
Yeah.
Great.
And then their third history class would be with a social studies, a history department teacher.
So you haven't had a student who's a level one come in as a junior?
We have.
Yes.
This is our second year of offering that course.
Yeah. Okay.
I'm very proud
All right.
of it.
That's great. I think it's great.
It's messy, but it's working. when I first started three school years ago, that was an issue we were having, and it was really, really challenging to teach. It was really tough for the history teacher. It was tough for us to try to collaborate. Most of all, really tough for the student to be able to access their curriculum, not just for the language demands, but for background knowledge. You know, for example, I remember he had to write an essay about the difference between the political views of Alexander Hamilton and Thomas Jefferson, so the Federalists, Anti-Federalists, and he didn't know who either of those people were. You know, so kind of like...
He didn't see the musical.
Before the musical.
No. And then, thank you. I think that's great. And then, are you finding more ELL students combined with special needs? Has that been a growing population?
It's always been there. Mm-hmm. It's very hard to tease it out, though, especially when it comes to level ones and twos.
Right.
Because then we're looking at testing in their native language. And if it's a language other than Spanish, that's going to be a challenge for the district. But it's something that we always are considering, and we do have SST to start that process.
Can I have one more question?
Sure.
I know Spanish is the number one language that you're seeing. What is there predominantly this is our next language, or is that ever-changing population?
We have a growing number of Arabic speakers at the elementary schools.
Yeah. Urdu, Arabic and Urdu. Yeah.
But that also changes every
year. Yeah, I don't know if it was something you're seeing, something like a trend, or if it's just changing. Thank you.
And at the high school, we're seeing a trend. Before it was Ecuadorian students, now we're seeing more El Salvadorans, which is a statewide trend.
Mr. Meyer.
What level of transience is there in terms of the interruption of the education within the Northampton system for the students that you're serving? I mean, is that something that's infrequent or relatively common? I mean, in terms of students that, again, you talked about students being pulled between two countries, and often students might return for a period to the country of, you know, their parents' origin or maybe where they were born. Is that rare for our students?
It's not rare. We're definitely seeing it with, you know, one certain group than others. But I wouldn't say it's a large percentage. Would you guys agree with that?
Yeah,
At high school, it's not.
Right. It depends. I mean, the housing issues in Northampton have always affected how long people stay. I just found out today that one of my families is, they're perhaps around the move. So it's just when we're underway, things can change. So that's what, you know, has to happen. But that's, over the years, it's been an ebb and flow. And I think that the stats that we had at the beginning from Desi, we've had less ELLs in the district, and that has a lot to do with housing. I mean, I've just, over the many decades, I've seen a lot of that change. And I know that people would like to stay in Northampton, but they can't secure housing here, so they end up going to another community that's not far from here, but there they go, so sadly.
And also, I would say the transience in the ELL population is, as you would imagine, going to be higher than your average rest of the population. So, you know, we get a lot of students coming from Eastern Mass and other states in New England. There is some transience, like going back to Puerto Rico, for example, because travel there is so easy for families. So going to Puerto Rico for middle school, coming back for high school, things like that.
Lori, did you have...
I would just say the answer to that.
Yes, Elena.
So I'm kind of like assuming and wondering that there's a significant challenge in the social blending of ELL populations and non-ELL populations at the high school. And I'm kind of wondering like what your experiences with that have been and what you guys do in terms of social engagement between ELL and non-ELL populations to ameliorate that.
Something that I think about all the time. I mean, yeah, like you assume, correct, I think it's a huge challenge. Students, and you know, you just, from our slides, they're coming in with many, many different kinds of some advantages, some challenges, and I think if you're already a teenager and you're already dealing with all of the other stuff that's going on in your life, and on top of that, you don't understand the language of instruction, you're struggling to make friends, you don't know who to sit with at lunch, maybe there's some discrimination, you know, it's really tough. And as a low incidence district, right, where we don't have, we have less than 200 ELL students across the district, it's really hard for us to provide a lot of supports for these students, also because we can't necessarily provide staff that speak their language. With Spanish speakers, that is something that I would, you know, we would like to see more. It would help a lot of our students, not just our ELLs. But I think we would like to do a better job as a district and as a school in meeting the needs of our ELLs with trauma, with interrupted schooling. You know, it's definitely a difficult task, right? There's always issues with our budget. We never have enough for everything, but it would be great to be able to help them more. For example, now that we have, you know, this crazy week, it would be great to be able to do more to support students with the fears and the worries that they're having. But you know, this existed before this week. Students having trouble sort of with, you know, it, maybe they're in immigration proceedings and maybe they work after school and they're having a really hard time balancing work and school. Lots and lots of phone calls home that Sue and I do, and guidance does. It's a lot of time and we would love to be able to do it better and more systematically. Right now I would say that's a weakness in our district.
One plus in the elementary part is that students are all part of a graded classroom. So if we do have a student who is a Chinese speaker, we might have somebody else who might be a Chinese speaker, we would say, well, that would be a good thing to do, to give them the opportunity to be able to use their native tongue with a peer. Because we know that having peers who kind of look and sound like each other, that it just makes it very much easier for them. And I think the nice thing about the elementary part is that there's always a place for kids to be, and we really work hard at bringing kids into experiences with each other. So it's a lot more natural, and I think that once we get into a secondary level, when you're in a classroom, you're in an ELL class or you're in the regular class, you're just, it's a harder dance, so to speak.
That being said,
I just wanted to add that we have been able to encourage a lot of our Spanish-speaking students to join the Spanish Conversation Club at the high school on Tuesdays after school, and it's been a really great blending of the two populations. And we've also had Honor Society students come during my fourth period content support class, and that has been really great too. You don't have to speak the language in order to come volunteer in my classroom. So it's starting. It's a slow process, but it is starting.
And just like culturally as a school, we're doing awesome stuff. Elena invited some of our students to, or reached out to try to get some Spanish speakers to guest host the transcript, which you heard about. So if you watched the one from
Special election edition, we have some awesome ELL students hosting.
Yeah. So. And you know, that's
another reason to watch it.
Yeah. And it's amazing. Yeah. But you know, little things like that, culturally as a school, we're doing as much as we can, and I think every year it's better. And students are feeling more engaged, more seen, belonging more. So it's, you know, students are doing an awesome job of that as well.
Are there any other questions or comments? Thank you all for this presentation. Thank you. We're now going to have an update presentation on the tiered support structures at Northampton High School. And I believe we have Lori Farkas and Principal Brian Lombardi.
Thank you for including us on your agenda and for including the wonderful ESL teachers too. I was really thrilled that that opportunity came up for them too. I prepared a little piece, usually I don't, but I wanted to include some things that were really important in general about student services in this district and in the state and nation. Student services has long been a place where the need for data to move forward has been significant. From the development of 94-142, which was the first special education law in 1975, we've been mandated to look at student testing and progress in order to make students eligible for services. Then with IDEA, our current special education law, we've been guided to further track student progress, provide tiers of interventions, and to use data in making specific decisions about services. As a student services director, it's imperative that I regularly assess the needs of the student body and adjust both program configurations and the personnel needs accordingly. Just like in any business and in any place where we're responsible for serving people, whether it's in a community or the community of the school. So I think that's super important. In Northampton, this has meant the movement of the elementary autism program to Bridge Street School, the split of the elementary alternative learning program into two elementary groups based on age, and a similar adjustment this year in the Bridge Street School autism program into two classrooms. We have also increased our staffing in speech, occupational therapy, behavior support, clinical support, teachers of vision impaired and hearing impaired students over the last 5 years to meet the needs of our student body. And that's all based on regularly assessing and looking at the data of who our students are, the level of need that they present, and not just our special education students, our students who are on 504 accommodation plans, and the greater student body. So as is happening throughout the state, the needs of all of our students are changing. At Northampton High, Principal Lombardi and I have worked together over the last 4 years to address these changing needs by supporting a wider range of students and supporting students before their needs are significant enough to need IEPs, but they may have 504 accommodation plans. I deferred to Mr. Lombardi to explain how our services have most recently been reorganized to meet those needs.
Thank you, Lori. Good evening. I'm going to refer to the handout that I passed out to you earlier. I'm going to read some of it and I'll do some explaining as well. Our mission at Northampton High School is to ensure high achievement by all students and to enable all students to become lifelong learners, critical thinkers, and self-fulfilled and socially responsible individuals who value and contribute to a multicultural and diverse global society. To assist students in their growth and success, Northampton High School provides a flexible tiered system of educational offerings and supports. The flexible tiers represent a responsive educational environment that provides students with a continuum of multiple supports to meet their needs. The tiers represent increasing intensity of academic and non-academic support and interventions. There is flexibility of the system and the programming to allow movement between the tiers. It kind of gives you a lot of verbiage and explain what it's trying to do to support our students. How we got here, I've been here 10 years and worked very closely with Lori over the last 4 years of how to best serve our students. 4 years ago and the years before that, at the high school, really all we had was special education, students on 504, and Florence Levering Center, and then an alternative learning program in the school. And we'd have a student support team, we'd have students that were struggling, and when it came to the menu of what could we offer students support, we were left with only two options. And both those options were basically taking them out of the mainstream, taking them out of having other educational opportunities, and a one-size-fits-all. They're struggling in a class for whatever reason, let's look at possibility for a special education referral. if that was the case, and you might put them into a strategies class, or you might then look at the FLC or the alternative learning program. As the population began to change over the last 4 years, we were realizing that model wasn't working. It wasn't one size fits all. Some students didn't need a special education referral. Many students didn't need to be in an alternative learning program. And our frustration was really taking a look at, you know, how can we meet the needs? Some student might need a math intervention. They might need an English intervention. They might need a support class to be successful in their in school. So we start taking a look at our staffing. And as Ms. Farkas said, that, you know, like any business, you look at your personnel, you look at your budget, what is the best way to meet the needs? And we took a look at the alternative learning program, where we had 3 full-time staff doing a tremendous job servicing 25 students. And as we were looking at the needs of students that were coming up, it didn't quite seem that those students required a separate alternative path where they would be removed from the general education. And we decided to take a look at, well, let's look at the classes that we have. How could we better use our personnel to create some other classes and create now a menu and a way of looking at our classes at the high school? So if you see the tiered approach, if you see tier one are the educational offerings that we have at the school, which are expected for about 80% to 90% of our student population. Those include all our regular college preparatory classes, all our elective classes, all of our honors, and our AP classes. Students should find success in those classes with best teachers providing best practices, following SEI models, district accommodation plan, type of interventions and accommodations for students. That's going to work again for 80% to 90% of our student body. Tier two, you're going to find maybe 5% to 10% of our students are going to struggle. They're going to need some support. That's where this tier two comes in, where we offer a menu of classes. These can be special ed classes. These can be accessible for students on ELL as well as regular ed. The goal is that they might need one class, they might need 3, they might need 4. It's very flexible, and it's keeping them having access to all the other electives and classes at the high school. Tier 3 is when you get to our most intensive. That would be a student that would require a pullout of class, maybe a strategies class, maybe our goals program, something of that nature. As you can see on the back side of the handout, I'm going to explain each tier a little more now. Tier 1 consists of core curriculum universal behavior supports, as I explained. The part about Tier 2, Tier 2 courses currently include our ELL program, as mentioned, ELL beginner, intermediate, and advanced, an ELL support class, ELL modern history this semester, foundations of math, a co-taught IM1, a reading class, academic support, English 10, 11, and 12, financial literacy, U.S. history, and integrated math 3. This model, as opposed to just having the strategies and the alternative learning program, where the alternative learning program had 3 full-time staff reaching 25 students. Right now we have 4 full-time teachers, 3.33 teachers, providing 15 sections of classroom opportunities. This year we're serving about 61 to 65 students and 81 learning opportunities in those classes. Some of those students might have all 4 of a tier 2. Some of those students might have, you know, again, 1 to 4 combination, which is providing them greater access to the general curriculum as well as being integrated into the, our student body. Questions?
Dr. Baird.
Is the idea to eliminate the foundations courses?
No.
So I guess my question would be, tiered support, great, first of all. But I guess my question would be, when you say and core instruction means on grade level, which would mean integrated 1. And so are students?
Yes.
I guess that's my confusion about why we'd have foundations.
So we have some students that we're finding they're not at the level 4, you know, IM1. So this is the course that we can offer them to support to get up to that level 2 access at IM1.
So it's a pre-IM1 course?
Yeah.
So they're not accessing core curriculum?
Well, Well, it is core curriculum, but it's they're not. If they went straight into IM1, they don't have the foundations, no. The foundation necessary to be successful there. But it's core curriculum, but not at a ninth grade level.
So what would they be doing in eighth grade?
So those students might have to pull out math in eighth grade, pull out special education math. Or they might have a Title I support for math in eighth grade, but have been tested. So we look, in order to make a student be eligible for that, we're looking at their WEOT scores, their Ames Web scores. We're looking at a lot of data to see if they can go into an IM1 that's co-taught or an IM1 that is going maybe slightly at a slower pace.
Yep.
With paraprofessional support, or if they really need a greater foundation, much like we're offering a reading course.
This could also be students moving into our district right. As well.
So I guess my question would be, or maybe more to the superintendent, but so if we have an eighth grade, students who are, I mean, the core curriculum would be the eighth grade curriculum. So when you go to ninth grade, integrated one is the core curriculum. And so I guess my question would be why we would not have students in that core curriculum with those supports and instead be accessing a class that's at lower grade level content.
So I guess I will answer it just based on my experience, not necessarily based on this new model. There are students who come from a variety of experiences, often special ed pullout experience, sometimes ELL experiences, who just are not ready to access grade level content, just can't do it. And if you force them in, even in a co-taught model, sometimes it's not appropriate. So I would imagine those are the kids that you're identifying
about
for.
A huge number
we're
of
talking,
students.
There's 11 scheduled. Right. And again, what we've found in the past is that when we've tried, we didn't have something to offer, those students struggle. And so you can, you know, the biggest indicator for students' high school success is freshman year. And if they're in classes their freshman year and they are struggling, they begin to fail, clearly they begin to formulate, you know, views of themselves, I can't do this, I'm stupid, I'm not gonna be successful, attendance fails, participation fails. So this is an opportunity when we identify students with the mechanisms that Lori said, you know, evaluation by the teachers, it's a support to keep them on track, to get them the skills that they need to go on. The goal is to hopefully get them to IM1, IM2. You know, it's not meant to be a dead end. It's meant to be something that's going to raise their level through intensive instruction, small classroom with an aide. And again, variety of backgrounds from special ed, some ELL, people coming into the district that might not be a K-12 Northampton. I think one of the things Dr. Provo said yesterday is we did, I think 400 students came into the district in the course of 4 months, 300 left, 100, you know, some of those students come with very diverse needs.
But you're saying in foundations of math, you have two, you have foundations one and then foundations two.
Had some students that are on that level. And that's in a class, it's a combined class of, I think, seven that the teacher is teaching very specifically. And that's the beauty of this, you know what I'm saying? If a teacher's in, if they were in an IM1 class of 2025, and that class, I mean, there is a point with differentiation that if they're moving the bulk of the class and you really have a student that is below grade level math, below the core level math, very hard for that student to keep up with the student body and the damage it can do to that student in that class.
So I just want to add that we've tried a couple of different things over the past 2 years to meet the needs of that picture of students, and this has been the most successful. One of the things that we tried was to have a strategies class that just focused on math, and that teacher would have a lot of regular communication with the math teacher, and it still wasn't as effective as we found this foundations class is in moving students back into that set core curriculum.
You're essentially saying there's 18 kids in foundations, 11 in foundations one, 7 in foundations.
Well,
one.
there's
talking about
but different grades, different age groups as well.
Nine, ten,
maybe.
Yeah.
I just want to say it really shows you that a good percentage of them are newcomers who are coming in from other countries with second or third grade reading levels in English. So the numeracy is going to be that low as well.
Yeah, I guess my overall point is just that, like, when we say it's the core instruction, to me, core instruction is grade level instruction. And if it's below ninth grade level, it's not really core instruction. It's supplemental instruction or pull-out instruction or something different, which is okay. You can have a modified curriculum. Yeah. But.
So
if I could.
Sure, please.
I agree with that point. When I read this too, maybe I'm reading it. When I understand supplemental and core instruction, it means that a student may be in core instruction for some subjects and in supplemental instruction for other subjects. Doesn't mean that
everything
the supplemental class is supplemental and core in the same class necessarily. Is that?
Yeah, because some of this, they could have a schedule where they're going to the regular English class, so they could be in a regular biology class. It's a very pinpointed intervention. Whereas before, the option was go to the alternative learning program, and everything in that class was taught.
Or go to strategies where you're getting help getting help on concepts that you may not even be able to access those concepts. So we're really trying to give students a stronger base so they can be successful in the remainder of their classes.
Ms. Hennessy?
The 24, 25, 26 students who were in the program with the three teachers prior to this year?
Yes.
I assume many or most or all were in for also social emotional issues?
Right. It was becoming, at some point, it was a very wide. It was some credit recovery, some social emotional, and that was part of the problem that became a one-size-fits-all.
So how are they, those kids who were there in that program last year, how are they doing with attendance, grades, and behavioral interactions this year?
We're finding.
I was going to say, in some ways, it was the ideal year to make this adjustment. Because we had 8 students graduate.
Yeah. Okay. So we had 9 students coming back in that model.
Okay.
And for some of them, we're finding success. For some, we're still seeing some of those issues. And again, this is a shift, a model. And if you look at this, we expect that there's going to be maybe 1 to 5% of our overall student population that's going to need something much different. Mm-hmm. And we're finding that we have like 3 to 4, 3 to 5 students that we're going to have to kind of figure out something for them to be successful in school. And they tend to be students of very significant social emotional. But what's nice about this is that we can be very responsive to needs. So right now, for example, we haven't set second semester schedule because we're going to form the schedule teachers are going to offer based on what we're going to find needs are from this semester. So if we needed some more Englishes, if we need a different math, if we need a science, we're able to actually create that with the teachers here. They're all special ed teachers.
And the smaller classes are dealing with, are supporting students who have a growing number of students who come in with a high level of anxiety or other mental health challenges and need smaller classrooms. Mm-hmm. If that is the only thing they need the smaller classrooms.
Okay, any other questions? Thank you both for this presentation.
Thank you.
Next, we have a couple of, we have a vote. First is a one-year lease extension. Okay, fine. Oh, sure, sorry, didn't realize that. So we're actually going to skip ahead to item I, which is Rules and Policy Subcommittee report and some second readings and votes on various policies, and I'll turn it over to the chair, Laura Fallon.
Would it be okay if I just skip right to the first reading of the policy, Mr. Tramfaglia, so that he can go home?
Sounds great.
So this is the first reading. We won't be voting on it until December. But it is actually the creation of a new policy, so I am going to read it for people at home. It's file EFDA, charging collection of payment for school meals. In recognition that a child's nutrition is very important to a successful learning experience, the Food Service Department will make accommodations for students who have no money in their account or have forgotten their money. As with any institution, the school system has an obligation to be fiscally accountable and cost-effective. In an effort to meet these two priorities, the following procedure will be followed. charging procedure. Number one, all transactions will take place at the point of sale in the school cafeterias. Number two, transactions may occur on a cash or electronic basis. Number three, balances may be checked at any time by logging into the online district food service account system or by contacting the food service department. Number four, students may purchase a type A meal, the regular school lunch, if they have a negative balance. It is expected that their account will be brought up to date by their parents or guardians. Number five, if a student has a negative account balance, they will not be allowed to charge a la carte items. A la carte includes milk purchased outside of the full meal. Number six, the food service director and building administrators will take all reasonable measures to collect money owed by the parents or guardians of students with negative balances. And number seven, all charges not paid by the end of the school year must be dealt with through the general fund budget pursuant to USDA federal regulations, but any charges covered by the general fund will not be forgiven until paid by the individual debtors. So I know that the director of food services is here if anyone has questions about the policy.
I have one question.
Yes, Mr. Moore?
What does all transactions will take place at the point of sale in the school cafeterias mean?
Basically, when a student comes up to purchase any type of a meal or an a la carte item, they have to go up to the point of sale system or the computer, which then the student would punch into their account, their name comes up, we can see balance and their ability to be able to pay for a meal or charge a meal or a la carte items.
But I guess what I'm wondering is, but can people replenish their account from somewhere else? Like,
yes, they can.
So, so that doesn't count as a transaction. I guess I'm just, I thought maybe it meant that you had to bring your money to the.
No, absolutely, and I'm glad you said that because yes, parents are welcome. We encourage them to do it a bunch of different ways. They can write a check and it can be deposited from a child coming right to the cash register. We can accept cash. Someone hands you $5, we can put it on their account. And the big thing that we're trying to push is the My School Bucks link website that allows them to do online payments. The big key for that is, it's two things. It allows online payments, and that's a small fee to do that online payment, but it also allows parents to be able to view their account and to see what balances are, and that's a free portion of My School Bucks.
I guess I just don't. All transactions. I'm just curious.
I think the heading is charging procedures, so I think it's saying for charging all transactions.
Not for paying.
Right. So the subheading, if we want to say, is charging procedures.
Not for paying.
Right.
I have a couple questions.
Dr. Perrito.
So I'm assuming there's a rationale for the a la carte and the exclusion of just purchasing milk.
One of the things that for a la carte, trying to track down if a student's going to charge an a la carte item, meaning either a bag of chips, a sandwich by itself, or even a milk. That's one. There's a reason why that one stood out on the list. The federal government says that any reimbursable meal has to have a policy. Reimbursable meal consists of certain components. There has to be a policy in place. A la carte items is something that it's up to the school district to either allow charging or not allow charging, but the best practice is to not allow charging for a la carte style items or items that are not a component of a reimbursable meal, simply for the fact that you would accrue debt that then you're not able to utilize for the program itself within its revolving account. You start to run a negative balance, negative balance.
But we get reimbursed from the federal government if they charge a whole meal versus just the milk?
Correct. There is a level at which on free and reduced percentage that you are eligible to utilize the milk portion of the free and reduced. But we're not even close to that level. It's a little bit over 50%.
So I guess my question, I'm just thinking about like our pediatrician saying, like, developing brains, drink lots of milk, and my kids drink lots of milk. So I guess how much would we be talking about if we still allow kids to charge milk? Like, could we eat that cost and not be that significant?
It can become significant, and I understand what you're saying. I look at just what the guidelines tell me and what components and regulations dictate for me. Milk is not it used to be years ago, milk was a component that the student actually had to take in an offer versus serve situation to make sure that a meal qualifies for a reimbursable meal. Now it is not. The only item that is a fruit or a vegetable. So I know what you're saying and everyone says it, but in my eyes, when we're looking at a reimbursable meal, what counts as it, a student could come through and get, I don't, this is, sounds crazy, but a dinner roll, a vegetable, and an apple, and that counts as a reimbursable meal. They do not have to choose the protein or the milk, and so you see the combinations that could happen. What they do have to have is a vegetable or a fruit. They don't push the milk at this point. They did away with that a little while back.
It's, well, I guess that's good for the vegans out there, or dairy allergic people like me. So the other thing I would ask is, it says in here we'll take all reasonable measures to collect money. I'm just wondering, that seems a little left to interpretation. So I'm wondering, like, what, I remember the high school days, like, you can't get your cap and gown until you settle your bill. And so could everything from kindergarten on up, anything that you've got left, you got to pay that so you can participate with graduation? Or what is that going to look like when you operationalize it?
Well, I don't think that will be a change in our current practice because we're already taking all reasonable measures to collect the debt. So what it looks like is phone calls from the principal, phone calls from the food service director, letters from the school committee attorney. If a balance gets egregious enough, we've discussed small claims court.
Does that conclude your questions?
Yes.
Just wanted to make sure. I thought there was a pause there. So, any other questions?
I'm curious because I know a couple months ago you came to the school committee with your annual report, and part of your annual report included that we didn't have a charge policy, and it was something that we hadn't had on the books. I was hoping that you could just kind of remind us as to why that recommendation was made and how we got to where we are tonight.
Absolutely. It's actually a federal mandate from the Nutrition and Health Department that says that a formal policy has to be in place in how you handle student debt. That student debt and how you handle it is based on your policy committee and what restrictions they would like to put in place. They don't provide the guidelines of what that will look like or that model looks like. They only say that a actual formal policy must be in place.
Right. So thank you. I appreciate that because I think the comments that I would make to the committee and will make to the committee don't necessarily, you're not really involved in those comments, but they would be that as we look forward, and I know our business administrator tonight will talk to us about the budget, and our superintendent has already put a freeze on certain portions of the budget for for the schools, because it's going to be a pretty tight and lean budget year to try to come in on the numbers that we voted earlier on in the year. And so I guess one of my questions too that you could answer is, have you seen in your short time with us an increase in the amount of delinquent meal accounts that are showing up on the books?
From what I could see from analyzing when I first started here where balance was, and then last year being my first year, we did have a small increase. And when I say small, a few thousand dollars over what we had. What I'm starting to see this year, the trend being, is that it could possibly at least match where we were last year, or possibly exceed that to the same percentage increase. The other piece that I think is important to see is that what we're slowly starting to see is the number of families that carry the largest amount of debt is about the same portion each year. Meaning that if 200 or 300 students, individual students, not families, individual students have a debt, 30 or 40 of them carry the majority of that debt. Another piece to that is that I'm starting to see that it's the same families. So that's also another piece. So there's a trend in which it could increase and that it may possibly be the same families, but the amount of students, it's really hard to analyze it as it's happening now because student debt becomes almost organic. Today, I always pay. I always have money in my account, but it got behind. So then when I run my report or I start to send out letters, if I'm behind, I get that letter and that spikes percentage. But then a check comes in. Then there are families that are just always consistent with that debt and allowing it to just go and not take care of anything. So there was a little touch on what we try to do to collect funds. We're aggressively, we did a bunch of things this year that we didn't do in the past. In August, any student that qualified for free and reduced meals, we actually, from the year before, we mailed a letter home specifically to that family so that they could get a head start before the start of the school year on filling out paperwork. Then the first day of school, we actually sent home all the free and reduced applications to everybody. A third step we did just recently was we actually tracked all the applications that came in, and that anyone who didn't fill out an application from the previous year, who we feel could possibly qualify or not, but were on that, was on that list, we sent another application home. We also sent a robocall home to all families that basically said, we're still accepting free and reduced applications. If you feel you'd like to have the service, it's still open. It's on our website. We're trying very actively to let parents know that if they need assistance, we can accept applications anytime, as many times as they need to fill it out. If you fill out an application today and you don't qualify, you can fill in financial status changes. Tomorrow, you can fill out another application and qualify. Direct certification is something that we have to run 3 times a year through the virtual gateway. It's a state mandate that we follow the virtual gateway procedures. It says 3 times a year. This year I've already ran it over 30 times just to make sure that I'm trying to capture any student who would qualify without an application. And we're still capturing some students, but it has slowed down quite a bit at this point. So the assistance is there to families to try to get on free and reduced if they feel they need it. And I feel that we've done everything that we possibly can do to help them or at least get the information out there. But I, you know, this type of a form is great too if people are listening, that feel free to call. We'll work with any family to try to fill out a free and reduced application to discuss finances if they don't meet that level, to try to come up with some type of a plan to try to help them. It's the families that just decide not to pay it at all that becomes the largest debt. And one thing I did want to say is that in the beginning of the school year, what we did this year was we actually cleared our point of sale system so that every family who had a debt started at zero. And the reason I want to say this on camera is because even though it's at zero on their machine, the debt that they had from previous years, families would still be responsible until the school district and administration decided it became bad debt. Otherwise, we count it as debt that's owed to us. So families who may look online and say, oh, they cleared our debt, great. No, the debt's still there. When we're sending out letters, we're adding that to that piece to try to see if we can collect.
So I think that's probably one of the things that can be really helpful, trying to do that early paperwork and processing. And I'm sure that in itself has made a difference in trying to bring down the amount of debt that could accrue over time. Some of the other issues that I'm sure that you're more aware of than I am is most likely just forgetfulness. So parents are busy, they think they can get to it later on. And I think what you said just a moment ago is very important for the public and others to know as well, so that if a family is in the red a bit and they send their son or daughter in, or they make a payment and they think they put $50 on the account and then next week they find out they're in the hole again, it might be hard for them to process and understand how that could be since they just put capital onto their account. But they're always working off or against that debt that may not be showing up on the books,
right?
Because they might be carrying something from the previous year.
Correct. And any family can call us at any time, and both of my secretaries who work in the office are more than willing to help them line by line of what they purchased into a system and to explain it all to them on what's going on. And then any other questions, bigger questions, like what can we do to help any type of either a payment plan or whatever, can go directly to me.
I'm really excited about this policy and the help that we're getting through the principals in each of the schools. I think as I've seen this over the years and thought about how to best try to tackle the problem of bad debt, I'm really seeing it as an issue not of necessarily parents trying to have their sons and daughters eat free on the tax dollar of the public schools, but rather there may be something more important that we should be looking at and trying to help kids and families with. And so I think with the principals getting involved, it may give them an opportunity, maybe with a school psychologist or some sort of adjustment counselor, to make outreach to home to maybe find out that, you know, these may be families that are just on the cusp of not being able to get free or reduced lunch. They might be really struggling financially because some family member might be out of work, or maybe there's some sort of medical condition, medical costs. I think we as a school district might have an opportunity at that point to help those families, and this may be a way to identify them, whereas we may not have known that before. And there's a lot of great agencies here in the Northampton area that could certainly help out, and it may be the opportunity for those families to get help if that may not have gone noticed if it wasn't for something like this.
Absolutely. One last thing I just wanted to touch on real quick, talking about the free and reduced applications and the ability to fill it out at any one given time. You actually reminded me of a point I wanted to make, is that a family can do it on a temporary basis. If someone gets hurt or if they need assistance or the financial situation changes, even for a week, a month, a few months, they can fill out an application and change it. No one should be ashamed to fill out and to receive that assistance. That's what it's there for. That's what we want to be able to do, is try to help families in some type of a need. There's lots of families that are right at that cost, the beginning or that line, that may not qualify but still may need a little bit of assistance. And free and reduced applications is a great way to be able to assist families in that case. And if anyone, any parents ever have any questions, they can feel free to call me and I can help them and guide them through any piece of that.
Dr. Bear.
This will be my last question on this. So at the last one, number 7, says that we don't forgive any balances. Do we ever forgive a balance? Is there ever a case where we say we're just going to forgive that balance? Or?
Well, that is the procedure that Mr. Tranfaglia was talking about, of declaring it bad debt. To my knowledge, we have not declared any debt bad at this point. We're still hoping and trying to work with families. We've even tried to bring PTOs in to help sponsor families to work out payment plans. And, you know, our goal at this point is to try to keep going and recover as much or all of the debt as we can.
So I guess my only point would be, like, I would defer to people on the policy committee. Do we want to then somehow say that? Because now would be the policy that we wouldn't forgive or have bad debt the way it's written here. So, like, the last sentence in number 7.
Sorry, could you repeat what you wanted to say?
Well, it says, but any charges covered by the general fund will not be forgiven until paid by the individual debtors. But if we do declare some as bad debt, we are forgiving it at that point, I would think. And so do we want to reflect back?
I feel like we had really long subcommittee meetings about this. I went to the ALT meeting and spoke with all of the principals and leadership, and I feel like we worked really hard to get it where everyone felt comfortable with the wording. So I don't know how anyone else feels about adding language, but I was feeling like we were all satisfied with the way it was as it is. Does anyone else have input?
I'm just going to ask the business administrator, from a municipal finance perspective, how would that work? Is your you know, your balance sheet, your audit is going to show.
Well, the federal government requires the school committee to cover the debt on June 30th each year, which is what Mr. Trinfaglia was mentioning. So we are covering the debt from the school budget and then hopefully collecting it after the fact. And we went through that when we did last year's. We are tracking it, Ed, for the last couple of years, and there was an increase. And then we showed how money that was collected late was applied so that our payment was less. So on one hand, we're covering the bad debt with city monies. So from a financial standpoint, that's covered. But then we're carrying, I don't like to use this word, but we're carrying a side set of books that says we still have people that owe us. Even though the city has funded that debt, we're still going after the families to cover it so that, in effect, the city gets reimbursed the following year with it. So from an accounting standpoint, we've covered the bad debt.
So we're not writing it off in terms of city municipal finance because we're covering it.
We're basically having to
cover it. Basically not allowed to write it off. We have to absorb it.
Yeah.
So it's more.
So we're using tax dollars to cover it.
To be reimbursed for what we absorbed. I just wanted to understand what the mechanics of it were.
I mean, at some point, the debt on this aspect is a relatively new aspect of the Fed's really cracking down in the last 3 or 4 years and starting to say that the local community has to cover this and you have to have a process in place. We don't have a lot of history yet with the long term, but at some point, yeah, we may have to talk about, okay, the student graduated 3 years ago. We're probably never going to get that money now. We're not at that yet because it hasn't been around long enough to get to that.
Would this policy then prevent you from doing that?
I don't think so, because it'll still be carried someplace. We just won't be actively trying to collect it if the student graduated 3 years ago.
It's just the list will just get really long.
Ms. Burnham.
I just had a quick comment that I really appreciated getting that robocall as an extra incentive for families that wanted to apply for free and reduced lunch, and I actually had meant to write to you and tell you I really love outreach in our community, and I think that was such a great example of a very easy outreach that's just so important.
Thank you very much. Yeah. Thank you.
Other questions? This is the first reading, so.
Just a comment, you know, I think none of us want to see a child go hungry. It's not good for education, it's not good for nutrition, it's not good for the growth of the child. And so I think trying to find solutions to this is the only right answer in a situation like this. But just trying to find that balance between what the right thing to do financially is and what the right thing to do morally is the real tough thing.
Okay, so thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Trafaga. So now we'll skip back up and you can go to the second readings.
Yes. So this is a second reading and we will be voting on it. It's policy BDE revised. It's fairly simple change, just changing subcommittees' terms from 1 year to 2 years. And so really it was just the first paragraph that was affected. I don't know if there are any suggestions people had.
As I recall, we discussed this at the last reading, and I will make offer the amendment to the first paragraph, where instead of saying a week after the first regular meeting in January, we will insert no later than a week after the first regular meeting in January.
Is there a second?
Oh. I don't understand. That's what we're.
That was part of our discussion, but it was never formally made as an amendment.
So
yeah.
So I'm offering this amendment.
I second you.
We would change the capital A to a lowercase a.
So there's been a motion made and seconded to amend the policy as presented. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, so now we need a motion. Someone has moved. Ms. Fallon, did you move the original policy?
I don't think I did.
I think you did. I'm sure.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. So, Ms. Fallon, why don't you move the original policy that we just amended? We'll get in our time machine and go back and amend it.
So I make a motion to approve policy BDE as
just amended.
Amended, yes.
I'll second that.
Okay. Any other comments? Okay, all those in favor of adopting the policy, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay.
The second policy that we will be voting on, it's a second reading, is policy BGE, policy dissemination. It's very short, but it has to do with changes made by the fact that we essentially are keeping our policies online and not huge policy manuals. There are, in fact, a couple of policy manuals that will be kept in the superintendent's office, but the wording essentially just reflects a more updated view of policy dissemination. So I would move to approve this policy as amended.
Is there a second, Mr. Moore?
Second.
Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
Which is to move the paragraph which says the school committee's policy manual should be considered public record, which is now the fourth paragraph, move it into the third paragraph.
Second.
Okay. So there's been an amendment made and seconded to the motion that was made and seconded. Are there any discussion of the amendment? Hearing none, all those in favor of the amendment, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Any abstentions? Now we're back to the main motion. Are there any questions about the main policy? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? And so our dissemination policy is now adopted. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Now we'll move back up into the agenda to item D, which is where we left off. This is a vote that's required to approve the one-year lease extension for Clark School at Leeds Elementary. And I'll turn this over to Ms. Walczak.
As you may be aware, we've had a five-year lease for Clark School to use some of the space at Leeds School. That lease comes to an end on June 30th. The contract that was negotiated 5 years ago has language for 3 one-year extensions to the contract. We've met with Clark School, with Mr. Cannata, and with Karen Jarvis Vance, the school nurse, because there are some nursing services involved, and have reviewed this, and we are recommending that the school committee vote to exercise the first one-year renewal on this lease, which would take us through June of 2018.
I'd like to make a motion on the Clark School one-year lease extension at Leeds Elementary School.
Second.
There's been a motion made and seconded to approve a lease extension with Clark at Leeds School. Is there any discussion or questions about that? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, so the lease extension is approved. Next, we'll move into a required vote to approve a job description for the digital literacy and computer science coordinator. I'll turn it over to Dr. Provost.
Thank you. This job description is completed in conjunction with the recommendation to consolidate IT services under the reorganization that was discussed at last month's meeting. Just a few things I would point out about this. The name of the position that we settled on actually comes from the state curriculum that I think this individual will be responsible for implementing. It's the digital literacy and computer science curriculum. I'll point out that in the requirements, we're accepting either a licensure in digital literacy or computer science, because there's a little bit of a licensure debate going on at the DESE level right now concerning whether or not to keep the digital literacy license, which in that debate really comes down to whether we want to be educating students to access apps and educational technology that's provided, or whether we want them to be writing their own. This I think will cover us in both possible outcomes of the debate going on at the Department of Ed right now. But regardless of whether they eliminate the digital literacy license and call it all computer science, I think that this position is really focused on providing digital literacy for our students. And I'll just, for the sake of the community, read the essential functions, because this is really the core of what we see this position doing. One, to collaborate with curriculum teacher leaders and coaches to articulate, coordinate, and implement the district-wide K-12 DLC-S curriculum, to supervise technology integration specialists, to work with the curriculum and student services director to provide professional development in DLCS curriculum and practice, to assist evaluators in monitoring in the implementation of DLCS curriculum and practices. This is one of the things that the principals have noted with their current tech integration specialists, having a little bit difficulty knowing exactly how to give them the best supervision and support because they have a very specialized field of knowledge, and so this person would help with that. Advising educators on digital safety, security, and ethical use. I think this is connected to discussions we've had around our own social media policy and some of the debate that has grown up around that. Collaborating with the student services director and building principals to develop and maintain UDL environments. That's a term of art, universal design for learning. Basically meaning that when you make tech purchases, you should be thinking that there will be a range of disabilities and a range of needs in your classes. So instead of making just sort of generic purchases and then later on trying to retrofit and get special things for kids, you start from the presumption that you want your purchases to be as accessible as possible to as wide range of students as possible, and just sort of coordinating that so that we're not just purchasing devices per se, but we're purchasing them within a framework that thinks about, all right, are we making things, purchases that are going to work for all students? Next, creating environments to facilitate synchronous and asynchronous learning and collaboration. That is specifically to support the Global STEM initiative we have. Some of you may have seen that we had a visit from one of the schools we've been paired with in England. And we know that some of the collaboration we're going to be doing is in real time, but that's a challenge, you know, because of the time difference. And so some of it needs to take place asynchronously too. And so having someone who can create those kinds of environments for collaboration. Next one talks about supporting Global STEM. Identifying promising new digital learning technologies and recommending strategies for embedding them within the curriculum so that there is some guidance. Obviously, teachers do this all the time on their own, but we don't want them to be the only ones who have to do it. We think that having some support for them in finding new digital learning tech would be good. Assisting the development of technology-related budget recommendations, collaborating with the CIO, essentially the city's technology person, to develop the district technology plan so that we're coordinating. You know, we have that, as I mentioned in other communications, we have a lot of shared networking services, and so it's important, I think, that the purchases we make integrate with technology that's being purchased to run the citywide network. So I think having collaboration with that on the district tech plan is important. Managing the district digital presence and online reputation. Had a lot of discussions about website and wanting to make some changes with website as a part of this. Vetting, implementing, and managing a sustainable digital learning solutions. Vetting there is very important. One of the discussions we had in the policy subcommittee meeting was trying to address the social media policy concern that it brought forward, and wanting to have a process for vetting potential new technologies teachers want to use. And then other duties as assigned by the superintendent of schools, so CIO. So that is the position in a nutshell. Last thing I'll just say about it is I really think this is an opportunity for us to become sort of a trendsetter for the state. As I said in communication to you all, I put this out to the MASS listserv and got really no job descriptions, but a lot of, can you please share what you get? Because we're thinking about doing the exact same thing. So I think it makes sense from that perspective. And so I just want to let you know that this has been through a lot of eyes, both within the district and outside of the district, of people who are knowledgeable about this specific educational domain. And so I think it's a very good job description.
Dr. Baird.
A library media specialist, is their license, is that their license? Or is that the same thing as digital literacy?
It's not the same. Library media science is a separate license.
Would that be an appropriate license for this job?
I think that it could be a second tier license, but I really want to go for either the digital literacy or the computer science coordinator, because a lot of the coursework in the library technology media specialist coursework has to do with maintaining and curating collections and things. The coursework that programs headed towards the digital literacy licensure focus on is really more in the details of these kinds of applications.
More.
And to that, I'd been thinking about that too, in terms of, is it too narrow of a description, but this is recommended minimum qualifications. So, I mean, assuming that if you had a candidate who in all other respects was the appropriate candidate, except for a specific licensure or a specific thing, that would not be a disqualification. Is that right?
Yes.
For example, I did think, I thought about this. You know, the driver's license. What if they rode a bicycle to all the Northampton schools? They wouldn't need a driver's license, would they?
That's true. Yeah. I think that's a fair. Yeah.
Are you moving to make an amendment, Howard?
No, it's just because it's only a recommended one, so it's okay if the candidate shows up. that won't be disqualifying.
Or a horse.
Horse.
I'll make a motion on the job description, digital literacy and computer science coordinator. Okay.
So there's a motion to approve the new job description. A second. Any further discussion? Okay. Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, so the job description is approved, and now moving into the next related item, the consolidation of IT services.
This also related to reorganization that I've been describing. In order to enter into shared services with the city, affirmative vote is required by both the school committee and the city council. So the recommendation here is to vote to enter into shared services. I shared with you all sort of the way we envision this working out, and so I'll just share it publicly. City would continue to fully fund the IT director, chief information officer, and its other current IT positions. The schools would fully fund the new digital learning coordinator position that replaces the current director of innovative education and technology position. Schools would continue to fully fund two computer technician positions, as well as help desk and student helper positions, though they would move over to the city's IT department under the supervision of the IT director. The latter two positions would be subject to reconfiguration FY 2018 by the IT department. It really is a 2018 change, because those are part of the funds that we have frozen right now. So the net effect of this would be a $6,000 savings for the district in the current year. That's the difference between the current the 6 months salary of the current director of innovative education and technology and the new anticipated salary for the position you just approved.
Do you want to make the motion just to get it on the table? And
I make a motion on the consolidation of IT services, and that's in accordance with Mass General Law, Chapter 71, Section 37M, consolidation of administrative functions with city or town.
Second.
Okay, so that's the required motion or vote on the citing the specific legislation. Are there any other questions that folks have about this?
Yeah, I was just curious if we have a way to track or pay attention to, because I'm assuming that when the tech people that are coming from the school budget are under the supervision of the city's IT director, that they would be able, that they wouldn't be like some sort of invisible line where they couldn't work on city projects, and
oh no,
vice versa, the city tech people couldn't work on school projects. But I wonder if we'll have an adequate way to sort of tell how their time is being apportioned, so that neither side of this agreement ends up feeling taken advantage of.
Okay. Well, one of the things you saw the, is it okay if I mm-hmm. respond? So so the city's going to be running IT for all city departments and serving all city departments, including now the school department. And one of the pieces of that is the help desk system, which for people who don't know what the help desk is, it's basically the online customer service portal that when you have a request, you have a problem, you have whatever, you make that request. And that's how IT tracks and then closes the request. So we're really able to track, you know, by department, by request, et cetera, how many requests are coming in. So that kind of data is available, and we'll basically be merging the two help desk systems into more of a consolidated help desk system for all city departments, including the school department. And so there will be data on that. Right now we have two computer technicians and the schools have two, and they're basically, we've already kind of synthesized all their job descriptions, so they're very similar on both the city and school side, so this will be pretty seamless, and they're all going to be cross-trained. And yeah, the goal really is that they'll be working, you know, these two folks will be working on city stuff and school stuff, but we know how much staff we need now, and so to do both, so that's why we're keeping the current number, and we'll certainly assess it as we go forward. Yeah. Yep.
If I could just suggest, I think what might be a more meaningful metric for me as superintendent is the functionality of our system. Mm-hmm. You know, because we have times right now, part of the rationale for this whole thing is to build in some redundancy of services. We do have two techs, but they have very different jobs. And the city has two techs, and they have very different jobs. So there are times right now where we can have a problem with our system, and the only person who can fix it is sick or on a vacation day. There's no way to get it serviced. So for me, you know, right down the middle, 50-50 split of time is much less important than just keeping the machines running for the schools.
Mm-hmm. I totally understand that, and that's why I think this is great. Mm-hmm. But then I'm picturing in the day, 20 or 30 years from now, and but you know, where if all of a sudden the all of that sort of tech support was happening in the schools and not on the city side, or all of it was happening in the city side and really not in the schools, because for whatever reason you had a fiscal year where all the problems occurred on one side or the other of the line, and if sort of it would be a mechanism for making sure that nobody ended up feeling like this was a sort of back doorway into somebody, some other portion of the budget. I just don't know.
I think.
That's what I'm assuming everybody's acting in good faith, and that's fine. But I can easily imagine a scenario like that where it could get used as a sort of a lever.
Okay. Yeah. Well, that's. I think our goal is to provide the best possible service to all departments. And the other exciting thing about this is, you know, we're all on the same iNetwork. And one of the things that our CIO or IT director is exploring is becoming an internet provider, which we're allowed to do through the Five College Network, which would be another way to save money for the school system, because we'd be able to provide internet rather than go to Comcast or some other. So it opens up a lot of other possibilities, I think, for savings and for creating economies of scale. But your point's well taken, but I think the way I'm looking at it is, you know, the school's role is to educate. And so to the extent that you work with technology, it should be education-focused. You know, maintenance and other things like that, that could be in the city or the schools, but it really, we're already doing it on a wider scale in the city. It just makes sense to just add that sort of back office, more maintenance aspect to one department.
Yeah, completely. I think it makes so much sense in terms of, you know, they're all the same machines, and it makes so much sense, again, because what we now have is this artificial thing where, no, you can't cross over that line and work on it, even though we have somebody working for the city. Mm-hmm. But they're just in a different department, and that doesn't make sense at all.
Well, one of the other nice things about this is we're going to be moving them into a new space, and they're all going to be in a shared space. So, and working together as a team. So we're hoping that that's going to work out. I think
Just to respond to that, too, if you look at the legislation, it takes the school committee and the city council to enter into shared services. But if in 20 years, when you're still on the school committee,
no, I'm not.
And you don't think it's benefiting the schools, it only takes a vote of either side to get out of it. So it's got to work for both sides, because one side can get out after. So
we have the same shared services. Votes were taken for central services and HR as well. So there's a history of this sort of consolidation. Somebody had a hand up.
Oh, yeah. Well, that was my first question, is how do we get out of it if there was a disagreement in the future about, you know, prioritizing tech services, and the mayor at that time decided to fund it less. But my other question would be, what if there was an education-directed source of funding, whether it was federal or state, that specifically was designed to expand or support computer infrastructure in schools? How would that work in terms of having that money flow sort of uphill toward the city, which is, you know, normally not the way it would be conceived if it's happening?
I don't really see that there'd be much difference from what we're doing now. For example, with central services, all of that facility money is in the school budget.
Right.
But it's overseen by central services working with me on the budget aspect. We're going to continue to do E-rate applications, which are only for schools.
Right.
But the E-rate application, working with that consultant, will probably go in through the city IT department, but it's earmarked for schools. And when the money comes in, it usually gets appropriated back to us. So I don't see there being an issue, because we can still track the money. We're still going to do school department purchase orders for this stuff. Okay. So that it does hit our budget. I mean, some of this we have to iron out as we go, but I don't expect any issues there.
So the salary expenses, the personnel expenses would remain within? They would remain within the school department budget?
Yes. We have both situations right now. In some cases, we have some of them in our budget. In other cases, they're assessed back to us at the end of the year. The plan for this is that the money for the two techs, the help desk, and the part-time technicians will remain in our budget.
Okay, so there was a motion made and seconded. Any other discussion about this? Okay, so all those in favor of the motion, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstention? Okay, so the motion carries. Next is a vote on the creation of the Gregory Stone Memorial Scholarship. I'll turn this over to Ms. Walczak.
Yes, your school committee policies have various categories for setting up scholarships, and probably the largest category is for a perpetual scholarship, and it requires a minimum contribution or donation of $10,000. And the family of Gregory Stone, a local artist, has pledged to do that. We've already received, I believe, in excess of $3,000 in donations. The family's intent is to get that up to at least $10,000 so they can fund a perpetual scholarship. And they're asking that it be for a $500 per year award to assist a Northampton High School student in furthering their education in the area of arts or any vocation in an art-related field. So this will allow us to give something for 20 years plus, depending on the interest earnings, to give a scholarship to one of our high school students if we accept this scholarship donation.
Make a motion for the creation of the Gregory Stone Memorial Scholarship.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion? Okay. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. So the scholarship is authorized. Next, we'll move into reports. We've already done I. We'll move down to J. Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, H. Sorry, another scholarship or another gift. Sorry. This is a vote gift in memory of Dorothy Hurley to the NHS band, approximately $1,000.
Yes. Mrs. Hurley passed away recently, and the family has asked that any memorial donations be directed to the NHS band. She and her husband were big supporters of the athletic teams and listening to band at the athletic events. So it was very kind of them to consider the band in her memory, and the donations have started coming in. It's possible we'll hit more than 1,000, but we had to pick a number to bring this forward. So we'd ask you to accept any donations in her memory.
I'm going to be honored to make this motion, as I knew her personally and her family and saw her at many sporting events. And so with that said, I do make a motion to accept the gift in memory of Dorothy Hurley to the Northampton High School band, the amount of $1,000.
Second.
Okay. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? So that gift is accepted. Now we'll move to J, the curriculum subcommittee. And we'll accept a report from the members of that committee. And I have denoted here Dr. Baird and Ms. Burnham as offering the report.
I'll be beginning.
Okay.
And Tom will hopefully be jumping in.
Okay.
So the curriculum subcommittee has met. Northampton Public Schools uses for its K through 5 curriculum math investigations. The edition we use now, Math Investigations 2, was written before the adoption of the current Massachusetts curriculum frameworks, so it is no longer aligned to our state standards. Because of this, Math Investigations 3 was developed. It now aligns with state standards and addresses criticisms of the former program, such as the lack of direct instruction and inadequate emphasis on developing math fact fluency. All districts that have been using Math Investigations 2 are now faced with the choice of moving to Math Investigations 3 or adopting a different curriculum that aligns with the current state standards. So in the spring of 2016, the curriculum subcommittee met with the director of curriculum, Nancy Cheevers, and she shared her research about Math Investigations 3 and introduced the program to the subcommittee members. Also at the meeting were principals, a number of school council members, and members of the public. Last month, we met again to review more information about the revised program. In this meeting, Nancy Cheevers shared more about Math Investigations 3, including information about how other Massachusetts districts are handling the changes, the student privacy protections provided in the online environment, which is now part of Math Investigations 3, the better developed support for second language learners, and professional development options for our teachers. She also shared with us the relative costs of the various program options, as well as the costs of a few other math programs being used in different districts. Before this meeting, a team of Northampton Public School teachers and the curriculum director observed Math Investigations 3 implementation in Danvers, Massachusetts, and Tom Baird accompanied them during that observation, and the report on what they saw was very, very positive. The curriculum director also surveyed the elementary teachers concerning the change to Math Investigations 3, with 100% of teachers responding, 67% favored moving to Math Investigations 3, 23% staying with Math Investigations 2 and adding supplements, and 9% saying just stay with Math Investigations 2. Just to preface this, we have used Math Investigations for many, many years, and there's a great deal of that we've already put a lot of professional development in, and our teachers are really, really comfortable with that program. So it wasn't a conversation about looking at a lot of different programs. It's really about this is something that our teachers support, and we've invested in it, and it's a very successful math program. And especially with these new changes, they're addressing the concerns. So the estimated cost of the program is $140,000. Mr. Baird also suggested that the transition be supported by at least one math coach, which we all nodded and thought would be wonderful as well. And the decision about the program or any additional positions would fall within the school committee review. It is anticipated that the FY18 budget proposal will include some plan for moving to Math Investigations 3.
So we didn't take any formal motions.
Yeah.
It was really just hearing the report and asking questions. It's pretty informal. So just to add on, so what are the challenges for not just Investigations version 2, but for many math programs, everyday math, math programs, after the adoption of the Common Core, is they were just far too broad. That didn't mean necessarily you were using every single lesson that was in the program anyway, but they were too broad, they weren't narrow enough. In my opinion, Investigations 2 and Investigations 3 are very good programs. They're one of only a couple that I would look at if I was looking at adopting a program. That being said, there's still some pieces that are not necessarily to the standards within Investigations 3. The series of classrooms that I was at in Danvers, the work that they were doing was not on the grade level standard. It wasn't bad math to be done. And in fact, it addressed a gap in the standards that I think would be appropriate to fill. But just to be honest, like it wasn't on what they were, the lesson was not aligned to the grade level standard. So there are still some issues, but there'll be issues with anything you pick. I think for me, from my perspective, the coach is more important than the resources. The instructional strategies teachers are using in the classroom are more important than what resources you're drawing from. And with having Common Core, having standards across the country, we have a lot more open sources that are really good quality resources as well, that are free, that are available out there. So I think from my perspective, the coach is more important than the investigation three resources, but I think both would be great.
Okay. Oh, sorry, Ms. Hennessy.
So it's a lot of money. I understand that. What's confusing to me, however, is removing because they're not aligned with the grade level standards, but the criticism is that they're not aligned with the grade level standards. I find that strange, but can you explain that?
I was not on the, on the visit.
Yeah, I wasn't on the visit either, Nancy Cheevers.
But do you understand what I'm saying? Yeah. If that's why we're moving and that's the criticism,
it was
a lot of money.
It was interesting, so I'll add on to that. So I was with Nancy, and so there was three or four of us that were going to a grade four classroom, and we went to three or four classrooms that were all teaching the same lesson that day. So we saw the lesson evolve over three or four classrooms, if that makes sense. So they started the lesson in one room, the next part of the lesson in another room, et cetera. The other team went to a different grade level. And so it was interesting, because Nancy and I were chatting about different things that we thought were really good. They were additions to the program. How they address back fluency to me is a part of how you address back fluency, and that was an inclusion of what we call a number talk. Mm-hmm. So kids were looking at a straight addition problem. They couldn't use certain numerals, and they had to make combinations of numbers to get to a certain sum. That was great. That's a great way to gain flexible number sets. That's not, to me, enough to address back fluency, but no program is gonna, like I said, have everything. But it was probably the fourth classroom that we were in, I started thinking, like, I don't think this is the work in this grade level. And so I took out my phone, and I went on my Common Core app, and I started looking at the fourth grade standard, and it wasn't there. And so I sort of I went over to Nancy, like, look, see, like, this isn't really the standard. We agreed that it wasn't. And so it was kind of unfortunate that that was the lesson that we were going around. In my conversation with the district math coach later on, I talked about, like, sort of some of the criticism about the program, that it's not, it was just too broad. So it didn't meet the Ed Report standard for even diving deeper into the program, the old edition. And that was true of, I think, every program. So not an unfair criticism. So they didn't dive any deeper than that. The new one hasn't been reviewed yet. It just hasn't been out long enough for it to be reviewed. And so my conversation with the coach was, so this wasn't aligned to the standard. What do you think? Are patterns still in there? Because patterns are not in the standards at all anymore. She said, nope, patterns are gone, which I was surprised. A lot of programs have been kind of stubborn about keeping patterns in. So I was encouraged by that. And she said that most of the content that really should have been removed, most of it was removed. And I would say that that's true of other programs that I hold in high regards. So it's a really strong middle school program. They put out their new edition. They were stubborn about some things. They moved some things to different grade levels as they should. Other things they kind of kept where they were for sequencing issues. But anyway, I mean, for good or for bad, that's what it is. I think it's investigation. This new edition is better than the old edition. We don't have an Ed Report on it yet. And that's where we are. But I think for me, just thinking about how you spend dollars wisely, to me, if we could afford both, I don't think it would be a bad decision to buy the materials. I don't. It's one of two programs out there that I would, if I was looking for new programming materials, it's one of the two I would look at. And given that we have a history with investigations, I could understand why the district wouldn't necessarily want to look at a different program. It's one of the two or three, really two best ones out there. So I get that the question wasn't necessarily, let's look at all the different programs out there and pick a new program, because you've already invested so much time and energy into this particular program, which is one of the best ones out there. But if it came down to having to choose between the materials and the coach, if we have somebody's in there coaching teachers on their instructional strategies, that is going to, in my opinion, get you better student results than purchasing a program without the coach.
Ms. Fallon, and then Mr. Reed.
If we were to stay with investigations,
we are staying.
I'm saying, are they similar enough that you can phase it in without it being disruptive? Like, if you were able to split the cost and say we're only going to replace these two grade levels or three grade levels, or is it too big of a difference now that you couldn't do that?
I would think that you could phase it in lots of different ways.
I would disagree.
You could do grade.
Nancy did look at two different ways, right? One of the phase-in models that we have would be to do 3, 4, 5 in the first year and then do K-1-2 in the second year if we couldn't afford the whole thing at once.
And that would be the transition, wouldn't it be? You wouldn't be missing something?
Well, you know, whether kids transition in third grade or whether they transition in whatever grade they're in, there will be an adjustment. So I don't think the downside of doing it in two batches of is the transition. I think the downside is we know Math Investigations 2 isn't aligned, and whoever is doing Math Investigations 2 will get another year of instruction in an unaligned math curriculum. Now, Investigations 2 has put out supplements and a number of materials to try to make it more aligned and make it usable, but it's to the point where teachers are pulling in so many resources from the publisher to try to come into alignment that it's really a lot to juggle.
Can I add one thing? Oh, I'm sorry.
Mr. Reed, and then...
Yeah.
I'm curious because when you did the survey of the teachers, which I think is a wonderful thing to do, maybe some of this information wasn't available, and so it seems as though the teachers weren't asked if you had a choice between a coach who might be able to provide some of these supplements and enrichments and alignments that doesn't currently exist in Investigations 2, would you be okay with staying with what you have and having the coach to supplement? Because sometimes a coach can come into a classroom or a building and say, you know, here's that extra enrichment that you don't have. And so that might compensate for the deficiencies.
I don't think that was Nancy Cheever's charge. You know, I think that she was looking at curriculum and Tom brought up this idea of a math coach. So those are two separate things.
I understand it.
Yeah.
I guess what I'm wondering is whether...
So she had already done the surveys months before.
Right, I understand.
So,
I understand. And I guess what I'm thinking is there a way to go back to the teachers and ask them that question? You know, would you be okay with staying with two if you also had somebody who is supporting your pedagogy and providing you with the missing materials?
Dr. Provost?
I would say staying with two can't be an option because it's not aligned. That's not even the option Dr. Baird was talking about. He was talking about a coach to develop new materials for teachers because the match just isn't there with Investigations 2 anymore. So I wouldn't ask them that question. One of the things we asked them is we need to move. Do you want to go with Investigations 2 and a bunch of other supplements? It kind of was that question, only without the coach. Do you want to throw out your old materials, start over with Math Investigations 3? Or actually, we did ask them, I think. Did we ask them just Investigations 2 and forget the new standards?
I didn't have that from my...
None of the questions were, do you want to go look for a new program? It was like, do you want Investigations 2? Do you want as it is, or like with the current supplements we have, should we look for other supplements for it or Investigations 3? And from what I remember of the meeting, there were samples of Investigations 3 in buildings that people could look at.
Yeah, there was a lot of samples. And may I add, in terms of the conversation that we were just having earlier about our second language learners, Math Investigations 3 has huge components to support language learners now. It has lessons in different languages, and it has an online presence, and it's really accommodating. I mean, one of the complaints that people have is that it can be language heavy, and I think that they have really listened to that, and they have really thought about that. So I feel, I mean, in terms of the stuff that the materials that Nancy Cheevers showed us really supported our goals for supporting our second language learners.
Okay, so this is a report.
It's just a report.
Yeah. And but I'm saying there's no vote. There's no anything else for tonight. So any other questions about the about this?
I would actually like to say a couple of years ago we were discussing subcommittees and the curriculum subcommittee for a few years, and I just want to commend you guys for being an active curriculum subcommittee and commend the administration for taking advantage of it.
And I'll just say quickly, I really appreciated the inclusive process. Like Nancy reached out, I mean, it's what I do as a math guy. I asked Nancy for ELA advice, I mean, so it's collegial, and I appreciated her reaching out and asking if I wanted to come on the visit. And she even allowed me to bring one of my teammates from my district so we could sort of both take a look, and so it was very much appreciated.
I'll jump on that. I think the whole way that you rolled this out and you and Nancy Cheevers rolled this out and really included lots of different stakeholders and is really great, and I hope we do lots more of that in the future.
Okay. Thank you for that report. Next we have another report. This is a report on the MASC-MASS conference 2016 and from our attendee, our representative, Ms. Fallon.
So excited to tell you all, settle in.
Blanky.
So exciting, my first conference. I presented with Dr. Provost and Julie Spencer Robinson and Carla Baer from the District Capacity Project and Emily Murphy, who's director of the Massachusetts Education Partnerships. We presented Working Together for Student Success. The premise of our presentation was that when teachers unions, school communities, and the school district work together through regular systemic collaboration, the effects of poverty and inequity can be mitigated. So we highlighted the whole process we used in forming the five-year district improvement plan and talked about plans for the implementation with the Massachusetts Education Partnerships District Capacity Project. So I think that it was well received by our enormous crowd of fans. Next, I was lucky enough to attend. I didn't even know that Dr. Provost and Julie Spencer Robinson were on the panel for another presentation immediately following that, titled Improve Outcomes with Student Survey Feedback, Engaging Teachers and Keeping a Focus on Improvement. And it was about our experience using the tripod survey in the district. That was really interesting to see, because somehow I didn't even know we were using it. I don't think so. I learned a lot about the tripod survey, and I'm really excited that teachers are using it. The focus of the conference, or the theme this year, was social and emotional learning and the impact of poverty on education. The overarching theme is a little depressing, because there's so many things that are outside of our control. Poverty, there aren't enough treatment facilities, there aren't enough professionals who are trained to deal with all these students with mental health issues. The lack of growing income disparity, the lack of universal preschool. So that's a little depressing. But what was really amazing and made me so happy and really kind of was reassuring was all of the positive things that they were recommending that schools could do were already happening, whether they're being piloted in the Northampton schools, whether they're happening district-wide or just in one school. Like, so many of the things that they were presenting on, suggesting that we do, we're already doing. So, for instance, growth mindset, by virtue of adding an additional preschool program this year, student perception surveys, meditation, the school family partnerships, and outreach that we're doing in the community, whether it be through NEF grants or through community-based functions or school district projects, restorative justice. So there were so many great things, and it was so reassuring to know, like, we're doing what we can. We need to do more of it, and we need to keep going with what we're doing, but I think we're really headed in the right direction. Now it's the bigger picture that we could really use some help with. But so that was great. And then I don't know if you all realized it, but apparently most school committees, they discuss the resolutions that are to be voted on beforehand, and they are authorized to vote a certain way on the resolutions before they attend. And you guys sent me there with free rein. I'm sure you would approve of how I voted, but the resolutions that came before the delegate assembly were, there were four of them. We passed all four. Resolution one was on the foundation budget. I'm not going to read you the full text, but essentially the Massachusetts Association of School Committees calls upon the legislature to enact the recommendations of the foundation budget into law, and further that the legislature order the commission to reconvene in order to conduct further deliberations and make such recommendations as the Foundation Budget Review Committee may propose, and further that the Foundation Budget Review Committee shall address and make recommendations toward the overall accuracy of the adequacy of the overall foundation budget. So that passed. Resolution two was the tax reform ballot question, and essentially was supporting the fair share amendment. The Massachusetts Association of School Committees, now be it resolved that the Massachusetts Association of School Committees explore ways to promote social and economic equity through a ballot initiative whose purpose may include a state constitutional amendment, tax reform, protection of the state's neediest residents of all ages, and seeks additional revenue only from tax reform affecting the state's wealthiest residents. Further, that the goal of such a ballot referendum would be to secure a stronger financial base to underwrite needed improvements in the infrastructure of the Commonwealth, as well as the educational, social, and economic well-being of its residents. The third proposed resolution had to do with...
Did that one pass?
You know, I was going to talk about all of it at the end.
Okay, sorry. said the first one passed.
All four passed.
Okay.
So the charter school reform was the third resolution, and they were seeking approval of a comprehensive set of reforms, including establishment of strict regulations or guidelines to require that charter schools enroll representative cross-sections of students residing within the school service areas, report accurate numbers of students who leave charter schools to return to the sending districts or districts of residence, require DESE to retain and report accurate data on enrollment of students with learning disabilities, physical disabilities, economic disadvantage, emotional disability, and status as racial and linguistic minorities. Require that any charter school authorized in a community without its consent be funded in full by the Commonwealth rather than by expropriation of Chapter 70 education aid from the sending cities, towns, and regions, and that state funding in full of any mitigation funds created to offset the loss of state funding for students who become students in charter schools. That passed. The fourth resolution was the social and emotional well-being of students, that the Massachusetts Association of School Committees shall be directed to deploy such resources of the association independently and in collaboration with other organizations to gather resources, identify strategies, and improve public awareness of the importance of addressing student social and emotional well-being, and further that we shall give consideration to such public policy initiatives that prioritize action by stakeholders and stakeholder groups in collaboration with expert behavioral and healthcare providers as the most effective entities for addressing strategies that are in the best interests of children. So these resolutions that passed are essentially, we are now giving directions to the statewide organization to lobby the legislature. These are our priorities. It was essentially an exercise in priority setting. There were resolutions submitted by a lot of different school committees from all over the state, and they have narrowed them down to these four as being this year's priority for our legislature. The thing that's funny is, these are in a certain particular order. So the foundation budget, like, they didn't even have to count. It was unanimous. I mean, not one person voted against that. And I've been warned the tax ballot question might be tougher to pass and to please be prepared to maybe defend it or move to question. And I thought, why would anyone oppose this? It was ridiculous. One school committee member after another stood up and they were like, no, I've been authorized by my school committee. We are absolutely opposed to it. And
it was unbelievable. Whether it was because they had an imperfect understanding of what the Fair Share Amendment was, or whether it was because they opposed taxing, and they, you know, would stand up and say, you started at a million and it's going to get dropped to 750,000 or a half million, and the next thing you know, it's coming out of my pockets. And it was like a spectacle that I have never seen before. I was very surprised by it. And just as I was about, I had actually prepared remarks because I had been warned, just as I was about to stand up and say something, the new chair of the Amherst School Committee, God love him, swooped in, and he was amazing. He just spoke so eloquently and with such conviction, and then somebody stood up and moved to question immediately, and that was that. Like, we voted. And so I think he managed to sway a few people, but we had to count person by person, and it was the narrowest of margins. So this, now I'm going to go off topic. I've been working really hard to try and figure out how we're doing so much right at the district level, how we get these things done at the state level, these four things. And so I applied for and was nominated by Senator Rosenberg to attend the Citizens Legislative Seminar. It was a two-day seminar at the State House, and we learned about the history of the legislature, the state budget, the formal and informal legislative process, how to stay informed by working with the new legislative website that's almost done, what influences the legislature, how to be heard. And then we did simulated joint legislator hearings and a simulated Senate session. And so between that and attending the legislative update session at the conference, I was able to meet with eight of our senators, including the chairman of the Ways and Means Committee, Senator Spilka, obviously Senator Rosenberg, the chairs, Alice Peisch, our representative Alice Peisch, and then Senator Sonia Chang Diaz of Education Committee, and also Senator Jindal of the Jalen of the Senate Education Committee. And essentially what we heard from all of them over and over was, yes, they want to address the foundation budget issue, and they would, you know, they're really interested and they understand that those recommendations were really valid. But the problem is that piece that's missing is the funding. And so every time they talked to us about it, it came with kind of this implication that was only going to happen if this Fair Share Amendment passes. And so what was really troublesome was seeing that it could barely pass at a school committee meeting when the people who are going to benefit most directly from it passing are struggling with the idea of passing it. I think we really are going to have to step up our activism and our advocacy on this one, because it doesn't sound like it's going to be as easy as you would think to pass it. I just assumed that the only people who would oppose it were the millionaires that it would affect, and it turns out that that's not going to be the case at all. There's a lot of opposition to it. So I have been attending our regional meetings, and the regional meeting that we had at the conference, we kind of agreed that our priority as a region is to organize for advocacy. That was everyone's number one agreement, that we need to really be on this, that we need to be tracking the legislation, we need to be in touch with everyone, because even with things like charter school reform, well, so first off, with the foundation budget, a lot of districts don't stand to benefit from this. So this is not everyone's priority. They were talking about it. The senators told us flat out that this will not change anything in some districts. So right there and then, we need to advocate, because it's not going to be everyone in the state that's going to benefit from this. But the second thing was, even with charter school reform, they weren't inclined to take that up. They felt like there's more to what they're doing as an education committee than to consistently work on charter school reform. And even within the group, I went to a charter school reform panel session, there's very different ideas about what charter school reform should look like. And so even with that, like, I really think that we need to be more involved as a group and active in this process. You know, as far as discussion about whether everyone should be opted in and then you'd opt out, or, you know, whether busing should be provided, but whether it's at our cost. And so things like that, I think this is something that's going to be really important in the next year or two. So I would like to see us maybe get more involved, and I'll certainly keep you all informed as to when the regional meeting is going to take place, the next one is going to take place. We're trying to figure out a platform that's acceptable as far as open meeting laws, where we can kind of all be in contact and actually be at the State House on certain days and be in touch with our leadership. So I will keep you updated, but I hope some of you will join me in this, because I feel like everybody was so effective with getting no on two passed that we should work just as hard on these.
Downey.
Mr.
Meyer.
Since part of your presentation at the conference was working with the unions, and I just think it's important to recognize how instrumental the Mass Teachers Association was in the overwhelming victory. I mean, they donated the bulk of the money to save our schools. They mobilized teachers all across the state. They worked, to bring this resolutions forward to over 100 school committees. And I think looking at the Fair Share Amendment, it's going to be the same partnership. So I think that we as a school committee recognize that we partner with our teachers and our unions in ways that improve education. And this is, would be a tremendous, tremendous thing for our schools if this amendment passes. And I think we should think about how we form that partnership even before it moves to the legislature and goes to the ballot.
I absolutely agree, yeah.
To your point, and unfortunately to your point about school committees being divided on it, the Secretary of Education, Mr. Pizer, has already come out saying he's opposed.
Yes.
Fair Share Amendment, and he's the Secretary of Education. So go figure. Ms. Hennessy.
I just want to absolutely agree with Downey, and then the good news in an otherwise interesting week is that I think a lot of people are willing to step up their activism now, and mm-hmm. So I think we could really leverage that to get the community involved, because it's so important, and it's such a great thing to focus on, too, among many other things.
Sorry, Mr. Reed.
I want to jump on what Downey's saying and thank the union, Northampton group that worked so hard on this. And really, Laura, that was such a great presentation. And seriously, I mean, it's great to hear about our involvement in these big issues, and I will happily help in any way I can. So.
We'll lead to it.
Good. Okay. Thank you so much, Laura. Does that conclude your report?
I guess so. Okay. I kind of enjoyed it. That's the most I've ever spoken.
Okay. Okay. So now we'll move on to the business administrator report and the personnel report.
Lauren, did you want to do this one? We'll get you there yet. So the first one is you have the monthly budget report in front of you. The main area that we're still struggling with are the deficits in special ed tuitions. We spoke briefly last month of the fact that we have put a partial freeze on some of the building accounts in order to fund that, and we will continue to be watching all of our accounts, basically, but especially the special ed accounts as we go through the next few months, and we'll continue to hope for a mild winter so the weather can help. The second item on your agenda is a copy of the capital proposal submittals that have been submitted to the Capital Committee. You have two sheets. There's a detailed, a lengthy list from Central Services that was submitted on behalf of NPS for school-related projects. If you look at this, it's actually a five-year plan. The five-year plan is just over $3 million in requests, but over $2 million of that is requested for FY18. Approximately half of that is actually MSBA related roof projects, and we are in the initial phase of that. We have approval already for the design, so we're optimistic that the roof projects will go through with MSBA funding and then hopefully with the city funding for the balance. I'm not going to run through each of these, but if you've got questions on any of these, we can try to answer those. And then the second related page are the two projects that were submitted directly from us for a school bus replacement on our ongoing cycle, and also requesting a vehicle for the attendance officer because she's currently transporting students and families very frequently in a personal vehicle.
Those meetings are going to start next week, Wednesday, and I am the representative on the capital improvements, so.
I would just also, with the vehicle, she's also frequently transporting groceries, furniture, clothing, trying to help out families, and it's not, and in my opinion, really appropriate for her to be using her own personal vehicle for that.
Okay.
Was there a reason that we didn't change the title to reflect the job title that we changed attendance policy to?
Well, the vehicle, so the current position is a combination of attendance officer, social worker, and adjustment counselor. The vehicle is actually more on the attendance side of it. I guess it could also be on the social work side. It was just the name of a vehicle to
okay, put on here. I just felt like from a technical standpoint, if the position was titled, what was it titled? We approved it in April. It was community outreach social worker. Is that it?
I don't recall.
So if we no longer employ an attendance officer, I feel like it's problematic to buy a car for a job title that we don't have on the payroll. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Well,
I could certainly clarify that when I present it.
Yeah. It was related to the attendance portion of her job, which is where it came from, but yeah, we can change the title. It's just... a vehicle.
Well, could we put it in parentheses? I'd be fine with parentheses.
Well, it's been submitted. It's just a case of when John presents it this week, adding that to the narrative description.
This doesn't have to be the final product because then I have to compile it into a larger capital program and make decisions, and so there's plenty of time to edit it.
Edit it?
I'm
I feel like what you're saying is there's time to, but you're not really committed.
Plus, attendance is really hard to print on the side of a van, so probably it's better to do, much smaller title. Okay, so continue. Are you all set?
Two other things. Each year when the end-of-year report is completed to Department of Ed, I give you some of the summary pages out of that and some of the summary pages I put together based on that data. So there's $45 million worth of reading there for you. And then the last item is the gifts that we bring forward to each committee. So this month we have one gift accepted by a principal from a PTO. It was at Northampton High School. There was a $50 donation from the PTO for the ELL Breakfast Cafe, which was actually a parent event, so it funded some food for that. And then there was one gift accepted by the superintendent, again, for Northampton High School. It was from the Ronald McDonald House Charities, and they gave a $1,000 donation in honor of the 2016 Local Hero Award, which was granted to Rachel Stavey Hale. So that money's been donated to the high school to be used for the support of the students at Northampton High School.
Okay. Thank you very much. Do you want to do the personnel report?
Yes, it's very short as we get into October. Basically, this month we had four hires, one ESP and three professional staff members, and then we had three resignations during the month also. So hopefully it'll be quiet for the next few months with very little turnover.
Okay, and now we'll turn to the superintendent report.
Thank you. A strong theme running through my work this past month has been responding to growing student need in the district. As you've already heard tonight, a turnover of 700 students, 400 in, 300 out. Now, those of you who teach in high schools are used to 50% turnover. You know how much that type of change can change the nature of a school. So district-wide, we're experiencing about 25% turnover. I addressed the faculty at Tuesday's PD day because many of us have had the feeling that this change has just caused something to change in the district. There's been sort of a qualitative change around the level of student need we're seeing, and I just wanted to acknowledge that for faculty. I'll say that after that meeting, several came up and said, I think you're talking about my class. Nobody said, no, I don't know what you're talking about. So I just wanted to let you and the community know that that is there. One thing that, I shared and that I think is not necessarily always talked about is that a third of our population now is either comprised of students who are eligible for special ed, ELLs, or students with Section 504 plans. It's one in three. Getting to the MASS-MASC conference, I think the sort of jaw-dropping moment for that, for me, was attending a session from Boston Children's Hospital where they reported on some research they had done with Massachusetts public school students, finding that 20% of students in Massachusetts public schools have some form of diagnosable mental illness, and that 50% of students in public schools have either a diagnosable mental illness, anxiety, ADHD, or ODD. So, you know, as I said to teachers, that means when you give an instruction in your class, half of them may respond in a way that you have not been, you know, trained to expect them to react. So the work that we've really focused on this past month is trying to build skills around helping kids who are in need, whether it's because of disability or medical need or ELL status. I mention all this not to make excuses or to permit any kind of lowering of standards, but just to share these sort of the reorienting experiences that I've had over the past month and to let you know about what we've been doing to refocus the attention of our staff on the real needs of our students. One of the main presenters at Tuesday's professional development framed this entire work that we're undertaking to better serve students placed at risk within the context of Stoic philosophy. So as a former English teacher, it really caught my attention when he began his talk quoting Marcus Aurelius, "The impediment to action advances action. What stands in the way becomes the way." And every segment of the training he gave sort of linked a classic Stoic philosophical thought with some form of dialectical behavioral analysis or cognitive behavioral therapy, strategies teachers could implement in their classes. As you already heard tonight, one of the teachers went out and started immediately trying to implement techniques, reported that it didn't work out so good, but these are hard things. You know, these are really tough problems that teachers are dealing with. So the work of this past month and for many future months for us, sort of following that Stoic philosophy, is going directly to the point where we feel least successful with students with the thought that that's also our place of greatest growth. Last year, the school committee made some strategic investments in different places around the district with schools and programs that seem to be beginning to feel some stresses from new and changing student populations. And, you know, I think that work really has accelerated change in those places. And so I think that gives us hope. I think we have some really demonstrable positive change in some of those schools, and that can sort of be sort of a guidepost for us as we move forward and take on this work at a larger level. Work is mainly on transforming ourselves to meet the needs of students, but I don't think it can be there only. And so here's where I want to sort of echo Ms. Fallon's remarks about it's great that we're upgrading our skills to take care of changing needs of kids that we're seeing, but at some point we have to say, why are the needs changing? What can we do to make our community and our society more child positive? And that's where I think we all share this work together. That's my report.
Okay. Thank you. There's no new business scheduled for this evening. Future business and meeting dates, the superintendent evaluation team will meet November 17, 2016 at 4 p.m. The superintendent's office will have another regular school committee meeting December 8th, 2016, 7:15 p.m., JFK Community Room, and then the Rules and Policy Subcommittee meeting December 15th, 3:30 p.m. in the superintendent's office. The next item is a request for an executive session, and I would ask the vice chair to make a motion.
I make a motion for a request for executive session in the JFK Principals Conference Room under Massachusetts General Law, Open Meeting Law, Chapter 30A, Section 21A3, to discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining case, whereas an open session would have a detrimental effect and further details would compromise the reason for going into executive session.
Is there a second to that?
Second.
The motion seconded. I would ask the clerk to call a roll call vote. Please vote yes, affirmative, to go into executive session.
Yes.
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 Aye.
Yes.
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 Yes. Okay, so the school committee has voted to go into executive session, which we will do now, and the reason for doing that is to have this discussion would have a detrimental effect on our bargaining position, and I also need to announce to the public that we will adjourn directly from executive session. Thank you.